weird desires and laziness drive innovation. And while we do still have the laziness part inside of us, I feel like most people don't have weird, bizarre desires anymore, bizarre aspirations and, you know, things and wants. Because we normally come up with ideas to satisfy our desires, right? Say I want to have a chair that bends in different ways, and say that the chair doesn't exist on the market right now. And if I want to generate a few solutions on how to solve this problem, I can either solve it myself and start prototyping a chair that fits my needs, and then start building the actual thing. I can then go and reach out to a chair designer and explain my needs and work together on building a new type of chair. And I can also do the lazy thing where I'm simply responding to surveys that are sent out by furniture companies asking me stuff like, how would the ideal chair look like? And with me doing a brain dump of all my weird needs and improvement suggestions in regards to a simple office chair. And what I'm trying to say, what I'm trying to convey is that without quirky desires, like without weird desires, good ideas are also put on pause. Because if there's no new desire, I don't have to come up with solutions on how to solve that particular problem, that particular desire, because there's no desire to solve. But if I personally don't need it, that doesn't mean that everyone on the planet is on the same page. Now, culture and the internet have transformed desire into a commodity. They play around with your cravings all the time, they adjust and tweak them out, gradually pointing you in the direction of their choosing. And we end up having sort of like the same wishes, the same desires that the culture of advertising has, you know, implanted inside our skulls for generations. We want to have an awesome job, great relationship, kids, great friends, and we want to see the world. This is now a default, this is now a standard. And then you go to the next step and say that you want to become a podcaster. And it's not weird anymore for, say, someone to want to become a podcaster, because, you know, everyone can do that today pretty much. It's kind of easy to set up your own podcast, and it's just like a few clicks away. But this desire, like 10 years ago or 15 years ago, this was a weird desire, right? People didn't know what a podcast is, and it would be weird to have that desire in the first place. And this is true for a lot more jobs that did not exist 10 or 20 years ago and now have become the norm. Stuff like data scientist, app developer, or, you know, content moderator, these are part of the new normal. And with that comes more competition. But one thing to consider when talking about stuff like this is that ordinary desires have already been satisfied and we hit a plateau. And there's going to be a lot harder to become a popular podcaster today just simply because there's a lot of competition. And optimizing the fulfillment rate of a simple desire such as how can I create a more popular podcast than Joe Rogan's is a hard, daunting task, and no one wants to do it as we are in general satisfied with the good enough. And again, the reason why they are difficult to fulfill is because most of them have already been fulfilled. So first, you can simply keep this in mind, right? Weird desires drive innovation. One other example I like to point out is the good old toothbrush. And I'm oversimplifying this, right? If it wasn't for the guy who was too lazy to brush his teeth, we would not have the electrical toothbrush. And while this is not entirely accurate, I bet that back in the day when the guy came up with this proposal and did some sort of demo to one of his friends or peers, I bet that a handful of them thought that this is kind of weird. Automating your toothbrush, come on, that's a weird desire. But this can also cascade into multiple other layers, right? Such as facilitating the toothbrushing for people with motor skill impairments and those with bracers. And this type of technology and micro improvements sort of set up the path for us to develop new desires and also come up with solutions for these new desires. And some might say that through our campaign of generating new desires, we might end up to a point where we will start addressing problems that don't exist. But I don't view that to be true for everyone. Because we as human beings are constantly evolving. And with our evolution to a new meta-human, we will have stuff that we want that we never thought we want before. Who'd have thought that a desire for software that can do live captioning for Zoom calls would be even brought to life? That was also a geeky desire to have maybe a few years ago, and now that desire is not weird anymore. Now we are living in times where digital communication is the norm, and there are plenty of reasons why an individual would want to have a file containing a text version copy of the presentation he missed. Now, I'm not saying that we should all start randomly generating weird desires, quirky desires, simply because we want people to find a solution for them, because that's not practical, that's not functional. I simply want to sort of go in sync. Meaning that you should think about a weird desire you might have, and often thought to yourself that it's too weird to discuss it with people, and think about its importance and scale, and then do the best you can in trying to start at least discussing that desire. And who knows, you might end up with a new project that can expand into something you'd never thought before. And this will sort of drive you to learn new skills so that you can come up with solution that will solve that particular desire. And I want to conclude the video with a small clip taken out of Lex Fridman's podcast, where one of his invites, Ryan Schiller, talks about how he learned to code simply because he wanted an app that would allow Yale students to chat anonymously and share what they really think about what's happening in their college community, and also tackle topics that are not being discussed during seminars and are sort of taboo.
The fascinating thing about your story, I think it should be truly inspiring to like people that want to change the world, is that you don't have a background in programming. You don't have even maybe a technical background. So you saw a problem, you explored different ideas, and then you just decided you're going to learn how to build an app. Like, without a technical background. Like, you didn't try to... That's so bold. That is so beautiful, man. Can you take me through the journey of deciding to do that, of, like, learning to program without a programming background and building the app? Like, detailed. Like, what do you actually... Like, how do you start?
Sure. I mean, I wanted you to be able to say a passing thought, you know, in class. Make a passing... Like, you're walking around and you have a thought and you can... express it, or you're in the dining hall and you have your phone out, you can express it. So it was clear to me it should be an iOS app. Definitely had it in mind that what I was trying to make was, I'm trying to prove out an idea. I'm not trying to make a finished product. I'm just trying to get to the first step, because I figured if I keep getting to the next step, at least I won't die now, you know? Like, okay, at least things will move forward. I'll learn new things, maybe I'll meet new people, I'll show a degree of seriousness about what I'm doing, and things will come together. And that is, as you'll see, what ends up happening.
So you got this Mac and you, what, like, go to google.com and you type in...
Download Xcode. And then
Xcode.
Yeah, and then I type in on YouTube, like, Stanford, iOS, Swift, enter.